heard the voice of the Lord saying, Whom shall I send, and who will go for us? Then I said, Here am I, send me. Anyone who has ever attended an ordination in the Episcopal Church likely has heard this passage from Isaiah. We know that the prophet has been caught up in a mystical state into the presence of God with the cherubim and seraphim in attendance. I want you to remember that these creatures are not benign birds or rococo fat babies. They're phantasmal, otherworldly, almost nightmarish in appearance. That Isaiah lives through this experience of seeing the King, the Lord of Lords, is remarkable enough, as the expectation was that to see God would be a death sentence. But to be cleansed by the action of one of the seraphim in his vision is truly miraculous. Is it any wonder then that when the voice cries out for an emissary, Isaiah is more than willing to volunteer, even though he's not fully aware of all that will be expected of him as God's mouthpiece. There's a certain naivete that surrounds Isaiah at this point in his life. Does he know that he'll be required to challenge the powers that be? In his case, King Ahaz. Or that he will present prophecies which will be rejected, or that he himself will be ridiculed and rejected, that he, by offering his life to God's service, will lose himself in the process. Now, was I speaking of Isaiah or Tony? Or both? Or, in fact, all who accept God's call to service? The answer is yes. In the lore of Anglican culture, there is a somewhat romantic image of the parish priest who celebrates the sacraments, cares for those entrusted to his charge, studies scriptures, prays the offices, and is beloved by all in the village. An Anglican Father Brown mystery sort of a chap. Without the murders, of course. Perhaps there was such a time when that image prevailed, but no longer are the majority of Americans active Christians or even believers at all. Spiritual, but not religious, you know, trumps the faithfulness to Christ in the church today. Congregations are composed of individuals who are on a wide spectrum of advancement in their own spiritual journey. It would be wonderful if everyone in a given parish were completely focused on a common goal of bringing in the kingdom of God or restoring all people to unity with God and each other in Christ, as our catechism says, or even such mundane focus as completely funding the budget for next year. Such, however, is never the case. There are some who, even after decades in the parish, are still seekers, maybe even a touch agnostic. Congregations that I have known are much more like the parish in the Vicar of Dibley series from BBC than any other fictional representation of which I am aware. Anyone who has ever been part of an Episcopal parish knows that we are a strange collection of pious and impious, faithful and backsliding, supporters of the parish, and underminers of anything the clergy and vestry propose. and yet, God's hand and call have been extended to each and every one of us. No exceptions. The choice to offer one's life in the service of God is rarely done impetuously, and almost always with a good bit of prayer, meditation, conversation with family and close friends, and the support of a fellowship of believers. And that conversation does not cease once one engages in ministry, either as lay or ordained. Because without the support of a community of believers, no one can effectively or faithfully be a witness to the God of love who we profess. I know a bit about the early stirrings of God's call on the life of Tony Hiatt. How I struggled to accept that call. The overwhelming care of the community of the combined churches and people of the Episcopal Diocese of Fort Worth. I know that Tony took a risk when he entered seminary at Bright Divinity School, spending much of his available time in prayer and study while continuing to hold a full-time job. Even that was not enough. As Tony helped restart Episcopal Curcio in Fort Worth, as well as ministering in his parish, and occasionally assisting with music in the churches in Parker County, and bringing God's love to many who have little or no church connection. But like Isaiah, Tony responded with, "Here am I, send me." And we are all the better for that decision. Now, blessedly in the Episcopal Church, we're coming to understand that call and ministry do not equate with ordination. For at least 50 years, there's been a movement to draw us back to the biblical understanding of ministry as that which Christians do. St. Paul, in several places, specifically 1 Corinthians 12 and Ephesians 4, which we just heard a piece of, lists gifts of the Spirit which equip the saints. By the way, that's every one of us, brothers and sisters. Equip the saints for the work of ministry, for the building up of the body of Christ. Does that mean ordained are superfluous? Absolutely not. I know you all are glad to hear that. Clergy, deacons, priests, and even bishops are absolutely essential for the ordering of the church, from the congregational to the diocesan to the provincial to the communion level. Each order may be seen as an icon, an image of a part of ministry in which the whole community participates. Deacons are icons of servanthood. They're not to be the only servants. Deacons hold up the servanthood of Christ and call each of us to become servants, especially to the hurting, the lonely, the outcast, fulfilling Jesus' command to feed the hungry, give drink to the thirsty, welcome the stranger, clothe the naked, visit the sick, and be present with those in prison. If the congregation is not being exhorted to participate in any of those aspects of ministry, deacons are remiss. Priests are icons of gathering and storytelling. Sacraments are celebrated within the context of the biblical narrative. And the priest gathers the community to hear the sacred healing story of God's forgiving love in Jesus, and thus to receive spiritual nourishment. That same gathering and storytelling occurs, or at least it should occur, within family life, between and among friends in what I call little S sacraments. Now, if you're not being led to be a storytelling gatherer, the priests need to get back to their work of teaching that all of life is sacramental, not just a few actions here and there. Bishops are icons of connection. One of the medieval titles in Latin for bishop is pontifex, bridge builder. Bishops are bridges between congregations within a diocese, between dioceses, between the church of the past, the present, and the future. But again, bridge building is a task for all of us, not just me or Bishop High or Bishop Halsey or Bishop High's successor, who we now think we know who's going to be. Well, friends, if you're not building bridges between individuals and groups in your life and community, we bishops are not doing our jobs of calling you to be connectors. You see, ministry is what we Christians do. Sometimes we do it well, sometimes exceptionally well, and sometimes we fail to proclaim the risen Lord Jesus. Benchmarks of success are fine for management, but faithfulness is our only standard for ministry. We're not called to be successful. We're called to be faithful. And ministry flows out of that faithfulness that loves the unlovable, offers forgiveness, and bears another's burdens. There's a customary part of an ordination sermon that's called the charge. The preacher asks the ordinand to stand and reminds him or her of the responsibility which they'll be given. So, Tony, would you please stand? Actually, I want you to come over closer. No, I'm not going to throw it. Well, actually, I'm going to throw you a few words on that. In the book of Exodus, when Aaron is set apart as the first high priest, the Hebrew word usually translated ordain actually means to fill the hands. If you don't already know it, and I think you do, your hands are going to be lip brimming full. You'll have more to do that any one person can possibly accomplish in 100-hour work weeks, and that doesn't even include your money-making job. You'll be tempted to fill your hands with non-essentials, such as iPhone, iPad, day timer, almost anything else. But fill your hands instead with a Bible, prayer book, a chalice, a paten, and a healing oil stock. If you don't have one, get one and carry it with you all the time. You never know. You never know what opportunities Jesus is going to offer you with people around you. Be prepared to be a witness. I want you to hear what I'm about to say and remember it for the rest of your life. In the examination in just a few minutes, you'll be exhorted to love and serve the people among whom you work. That means all of them. Not just a few, not just your friends. Love is a choice, not a sensation. Make sure you love especially those that disagree with you and those you don't like. That may be the most difficult action you take, but you must love the people among whom you serve. They will know whether you love them or not, and they will respond accordingly. The most painful words I ever heard was from a congregation who said to me, "Our priest doesn't love us." If Jesus had only loved those whom he agreed with or was close to, we'd be in a world of hurt today. Follow Jesus. Love those to whom you're called. Now, because of who you are, you won't have the opportunity to spend your entire day and week sitting in an office piously waiting for parishioners to come and learn from the deep well of your wisdom. Because you spend much of your time away from the parish church, you'll have an opportunity that most full-time clergy do not have. You'll be part of many other communities, and we'll be able to bring good news into the empty desert of many lives. Well, I challenge you to encourage the parishioners among whom you work to get out of the ghetto of the church and see the needs around them and then do what they can to meet those needs. To gather those, to tell that story. Show us through your life by being out and about what it means to be in the world but not of it. Teach us all to be witnesses for Christ in all ways. Did I say love the people among whom you work? I can't stress that enough. It's worth saying again and again and again. Forget your beloved. Remember, you enter the institution of marriage long before you took vows of ordination. Remember also, she will never let you forget who you are. Sometimes to your elation, and sometimes to deflate an overly large ego. But always set aside time for her. After God, she's most important. Finally, lose the possessive "my" when referring to ministry. It is not your ministry. Ministry belongs to Christ Jesus, and you have been given the extreme privilege of participating. It may take a while to let go of this last habit as it is used ubiquitously, but begin tomorrow to train yourself to speak of the parish I serve, or the work of priesthood, whatever. Don't speak of my priesthood as if you had a grasp on it, or my ministry as if it were really yours. Give that. I want to ask the congregation now if you all would stand, because I have a part of you as well. I want to congratulate your bishop, your rector, your vestry for having the great insight of calling Tony to serve among you. Obviously, I hold him in great esteem, and I want the very best for him as he learns to wear the mantle which has been cast upon him. Earlier this morning, you made a vow to support Tony. So now I call you to help him grow to be the very best priest in the Western Hemisphere. Challenge him to stretch further than he thinks he might. Love him when he excels, as well, and maybe even more importantly, when he fails. Laugh with him, cry with him, and pray for him a lot. He's going to need it to continue to learn and grow and mature. Help him to remember why he fell in love with Jesus and the church, and be for him icons of God's love. Be the body of Christ together, that the broken and hurting people in this part of Fort Worth may experience the good news of God's unconditional love for everyone and forgiveness through you all. Hallelujah! Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.